Hey guys, this is Eckhart's Letter. Hello and welcome to another Star Wars video. Now, before we begin, today is a big day for me because I will be participating in the Calrissian Cup, a Star Wars Squadrons tournament with prize money and everything. There's 64 teams. One will come out at the end of the weekend victorious. If you guys want to watch that live, you can go over to my second channel, X2. We'll be starting today, I think at around 2 o'clock Eastern time, but the stream should be scheduled by now. Anyway, I hope to see some of you there. With that being said, today we're talking about something pretty relevant to that. We're taking a look at starship design, and in particular, comparing the Imperial-class Star Destroyer with the Harrower-class, the Sith Star Destroyer from the Old Republic era. Now, we're not doing a straight-up battle here because, let's be honest, the Harrower is at a massive disadvantage. It's half the size of the ISD and far, far older, so it can't compare in a head-to-head battle. Instead, we'll be looking at which ship is better designed, taking into account the fact that they're both meant for a very similar role. So we'll be looking at several categories, including general design principles, weaponry, things like hangar design, but this isn't a strict sort of overview. We'll be doing a holistic comparison, so most of these categories will blend into each other pretty seamlessly. With that being said, let's talk about general design. And of course, both the ISD, and I think for the purposes of this video, we'll use the ISD-2, which is the ship that we see in episode 5 and 6, and the Harrower are Star Destroyers, so they share several common aspects, most notably the arrow shape and a lot of guns. There are, of course, some differences, though. The Harrower is wider proportionally. It has a big slab right out the middle where several hangar bays are located, and it lacks the large imposing superstructure and bridge that the ISD usually sports. Both ships have an Oreo-style trench that runs around their outsides, but generally, in terms of basic design, I do see both positives and negatives when it comes to the Harrower. Now, I'll leave the discussion of the hangar until later, and we'll also talk about weapons later, because those are both really big points. When it comes to general design, I think the Harrower's best feature compared to the Imperial Star Destroyer is its flatness. I mean, everyone knows that the ISD has that really overexposed bridge. Now, in an ideal situation, as we discussed in a prior video, that bridge and the shield generators and sensors adorning it will be protected by a very powerful shield, but as we know, that's not always the case, and from that exposed position, even when protected by turbo lasers, the bridge and lots of sensitive bits of the ship are a target. Now, of course, the Harrower does also have a somewhat exposed bridge, but it's protected by several very powerful turbo laser banks, and it's much closer to the body of the ship itself. So if you're a starfighter attacking a Harrower, you really need to get very, very close to the thing to hope to do any sort of damage to the command center. I will say, though, as we see in one of the cinematic trailers for the Old Republic, one of the Harrower's more baffling design choices is the fact that you can essentially fly through the exterior of the ship where the big gun banks are. Now, granted, that will be very, very difficult. There was also a weird sort of issue we saw with the Resurgent, for example. When it came to large Imperial ships, the Rebel Alliance would often use trench run disease. It was basically the idea that you fly very close to the surface of the ship and you use the nooks and crannies available to help avoid point defense laser cannons. If you've got somewhere that enemy fighters can fly through and probably do some damage, well, I think that's a bit of an oversight. And I mean, we see a freighter do it, so I've got no doubt that a small Republic starfighter could easily fly through that portion of the ship if piloted by someone skilled enough. We should also talk about shield generators, and I think most of you probably know about the Imperial Star Destroyer's shield generator placement. You can check out a video I did on that the other day. The Harrower takes a different approach. Rather than having two generators, it has four. And I actually couldn't see the generators on the render. It's because they're not there. Thankfully, my friend Flavi sent me some really good screenshots, which shows their position from the Old Republic, and the ship does essentially have ISD-style generator bulbs, but they're spread across the entire hull. That probably means some redundant shield technology, but it may also mean that certain sections are powered primarily by certain shield projectors. Still, generally, the approach taken by the Harrower is the one used by most starships throughout the galaxy. The Imperial Star Destroyer is pretty unique in that it has shield generators right next to each other, powering the entire ship. Something like a Mon Calamari cruiser, for example, has them embedded within the hull. They do think, all of that information notwithstanding, it is the better approach, just simply from the fact that you can't take both out in the same place. That being said, each individual projector seems to be a lot less protected. I mean, I've given the ISD a lot of heat in its day, but you realize, especially when you play something like Squadrons, that to get where the shields are on the Star Destroyer, you've got to fly over a massive superstructure of turbo lasers and missile launchers, and it's just not a good time. So I think the question is it easier to take out two sets of less protected shield generators that are technically closer to the hull, or is it easier to take out the ISD's shields? So I think there's a good debate to be made either way, but we'll come back to that. Another feature of the Harrower is its two engines. I don't really see any difference between the ISD and two Harrower engines. I mean, yeah, it has one left, but I'm sure the propulsion is comparable, and any difference between propulsion is probably explainable by technology and not design. I guess technically you're leaving yourself more vulnerable to having an engine destroyed, but I don't really know. Not much to talk about there. I do want to move on to weaponry though, and this is an area where I think the Harrower does have a distinct advantage, and this is partially due to the lack of a very large superstructure in the middle of the ship. Instead of a large square, we sort of have a pointed triangle. And another interesting feature is that a lot of the Harrower's big guns are actually placed on the superstructure itself, some even near the bridge, where they've got a shot of the entire battle. When you talk about the Imperial Star Destroyer, the ship is limited in some cases. It has to tilt forward to fire an enemy ship. This is something we can see in Rogue One. Two of the four double turbo lasers, the big double turbo lasers near the back of the ISD, cannot fire during part of the battle because of the position the ship's in. The Harrower sort of goes with double layered barbettes on each side of the superstructure, then has a crown of turbo lasers at the top. I really like the crown because they can very easily hit opponents right ahead of them. And that gun in the center can also easily hit targets pretty much anywhere. The two banks of turbo lasers are also really well suited for attacking enemies on the broadside, although the back half of those will also probably suffer when firing straight ahead, unless the Harrower does take a dramatic tilt. Aside from that, things I think are pretty comparable. The Harrower just has a bit more space, at least proportionally, because it doesn't have a lot of its topside taken up by the bridge. But otherwise, the Harrower does have, I think, a good mix of turbo lasers, laser cannons, i.e. point defense cannons, ion cannons, and various other munitions launchers. When we talk about the Imperial II Star Destroyer, we do have that issue where those really effective guns, those big guns on either side of the superstructure, are mostly meant for broad siding. Although, yeah, if the Star Destroyer tilts forward, it can quite easily put more fire on an enemy, but for some reason, that's not something we see them often do. Still, I think the lack of some nice central guns does hurt it a little bit in comparison, and technically the ISD-2 lacks point defense cannons. I don't want to focus on that because although it's a huge issue that takes away from the overall effectiveness of the ship without support, it was pretty arbitrary for me to just choose the ISD-2 over the ISD-1. The Harrower is also a little difficult to judge because different models have somewhat different weapons configurations. Most of them have some of the good features I mentioned, notably those big racks of turbo lasers, but some renders even have more. The Imperial Star Destroyer seems to concentrate a lot of its weapons in that brim that wraps around the ship, again making it really effective for broadsides, but I think also somewhat limiting the firing arcs of some of those guns. Let's move on though, and I think the biggest distinguishing feature between these two ships is the hangar. The Harrower obviously goes with a pronged approach. There's a big central portion of the ship missing and replaced with big hangar bays. Now on the Imperial Star Destroyer, there would be guns and extra armor there. Instead, on the Harrower, you're trading that for hangar space. Is that good? Some of you might be expecting me to really like this design choice, but personally, I'm not a big fan of forward-facing hangar bays. I don't think there's a lot of benefit to launching your fighters straight out the front of your capital ship, especially during battle. I mean, if you're fighting with another capital ship and you're trying to launch fighters and you're exchanging gunfire, some of your ships are going to be lost. The inside prow also has multiple smaller hangar bays. I mean, that's kind of a nice feature because if one gets destroyed, you do have the option of launching elsewhere, and I guess you can carry more fighters, but I gotta say this doesn't really do it for me, and I think I actually prefer the Imperial II Star Destroyer's hangar, which is just on the bottom of the ship, and you can do cool things like tilting the ship or using a Marg Sable to protect or screen your fighters. I don't know, I just don't think this is really the right way to do it. And we can also talk about those notches in the side of the ship. We see hangar bays there, but if you're going to go with the notched approach, why not have the hangar set back in a little bit more so fighters have just a little bit more protective coverage? Now, often of course there will be a shield there, but in Star Wars, when shields are pounded away, certain sections will fail. And I mean, one of the first sections of a ship to fail will be the shield right at the front. So I think you're leaving your hangars quite vulnerable, those two large ones especially. Regarding the actual wings itself, I don't really see a huge benefit to that. I mean, especially because they're not packing on any more guns or anything there. I think it's more of a stylistic choice than anything else. Bit of differentiation from the regular Star Destroyer, but kind of similar to certain Victory models. So I've mostly been framing this discussion around the Harrower because I think that's the ship most of you guys are probably less familiar with, and the one I've spent less time breaking down on the channel. There are a few more things I'd like to mention though in the ISD's favor. First of all, although those sensor bulbs and shield generators are quite a target, I think you do have to give credit for the fact that the ISD clearly is meant as a command ship. Like, those sensor bulbs probably give you a lot of battlefield data, which will be very, very useful. Proportionally, I also don't think you can ignore the fact that the ISD spends so much of its space housing a massive generator, making the thing just an absolutely powerful vessel. You can see in this undershot that the Harrower doesn't dedicate the same amount of space, and we can also see that it does have at least one hangar bay on the bottom. And yeah, that doesn't take away from the fact that those two hangars on the front are a weakness. Like, not every hangar within the ship would be connected, so by putting starfighters there, it's not like you can magically teleport them to hangar space that doesn't exist on the bottom, thus removing the weakness, at least in my opinion. So I think that's a pretty good discussion, and the question is, where do we come down? Which ship is better designed? And it's hard to tell, despite the fact that everyone on YouTube, including myself, has pointed out the many, many issues with the Imperial Star Destroyer. It was undoubtedly a fearsome design. It was smart of it to dedicate so much of its room to Imperial power generators. It's very effective at just pure blunt firepower. It is devastating in broadsides and very effective in frontal assaults. And it was used by not only the Empire, but later states, including the New Republic, which took whatever they could get and kept the ship in use for perhaps 100 years. That being said, the Harrower still manages to be pretty much effective. I do think the use of those hangar bays in the front is quite a weakness. I think you're leaving your starfighters vulnerable if they're not launched before battle or if they're launched in the heat of battle. I think it's weird how you can essentially fly through the ship and that leaves you a little bit open to trench run disease, but I like the placement of the weapons on the Harrower more, and I think just generally that's due to the fact that it doesn't have that massive command bridge. Now, of course, that command bridge does have benefits. It does probably have lots of advanced technology. It has those sensors, it's intimidating, and I guess it gives you a good view of the battle as well. But the Harrower does a good job with that extra space, not only with weapons, but with making a squat bridge that is probably more well protected by guns. It has those nice guns in the middle of the ship and across the entire ship. It's got room for lots of big turbo laser banks. So just generally, I think the Harrower is a slightly better design, but it's actually a lot closer than I would have thought, especially had you asked me this, you know, maybe a week or so before I really looked into this. I think things like the shield bulbs get identified a lot as key issues, but they're just really symptoms of overall design choices, which I think are less important than the whole thing taken holistically. And however, it's just my opinion. I know there's a lot of ISD stands out there, so did I get this one wrong? I'm sure you will let me know down in the chat. Till next time though, guys, this has been your host, Eckhart's Letter. As always, be safe. Don't forget you can check me out over on X2, where I'll be participating in the Star Wars Squadrons tournament today. But until then, have a good one, be safe, and may the Force be with you.